Press record. Hello, everyone. Hello, Carl and Jorge. Hello. We can't see you yet. And Kian, hi.
Hello.
I just arrived in Mexico and it's cold. And so I have a cold and it's weird. I haven't been in a cold place for a year, but my whole body is adjusting. And anyway, I had this question about whether our body is used to a certain kind of environment. And then when we change the whole environment, I was in a tropical, humid place, and here it's totally dry and cold. And it's how does our body say, you know, handle that kind of shifts? And I haven't got an answer yet, but if you know anything about that, I'd be interested. Greetings to everybody else. Aquarius, Dorothea, Devin, and Marin. Hello.
Greetings.
Hi.
Okay. We haven't seen each other for about 3 weeks. Is there any questions? This is Possibility Team Space Holder Skills. Any question about space holding or any sharings or places where you found yourself, whatever, at a dead end, or you didn't know what to do, or it was a new space, or anything?
I was holding space for distilling bright principles process for the people out with no context of PM, and I had it was challenging for me because everybody was, there was a lot of new matrix and everybody was going into their head and started discussing. For example, somebody said that love is a feeling, and there is discussion going on. And in some way, it's good that there is discussion going on because it's aliveness, and I see that it's nice. But on the other hand, I have something to do and I have some time to do it, and there is a lot of discussion, and people don't see that they are discussing and how to handle this.
Okay, where did you get this impulse to deliver this bright principle? Was it requested or what?
It was my idea. It was in my company, and I want to my company to be purpose driven, and so I started with this, and then I want to distill the bright principles for the whole team. And
are you the space holder? Are you the main space holder for your company?
Yes, I. On this process, I was, and I am one of the owners of the company.
Okay. This is a kind of a general announcement for everybody, is that I don't recommend distilling your bright principle, distilling your bright principle, other people's bright principle, or game world's bright principle until people can feel, can really feel. Because otherwise, it's a concept. It's an idea. It's like, God, kind of be great to be love. Kind of be great to be transformation, you know, but it's a completely different shift of identity to look in the mirror or to interact with people, interact with your partner, interact with the world as what I am is transformation. So when people talk to me, what they get is transformation. And that's not an idea. That is a shift of identity. And so then it destroys what the bright principles are. It makes it into a concept and an idea instead of what it really is, a force of nature. And people who can't have access to their feeling don't have access to their heart, don't have access to their energetic body, don't have access to their archetypal body. They basically don't have access to the underworld or the upper world. You know, without access to the underworld, you don't get access to the upper world. And so most people who don't have whatever, the gateway access to the feelings, live in the middle world. So it's money and property and busy and work and the house and I have to cook and logistics and, you know, do I have a girlfriend? Do I have a boyfriend? You know, whatever. This is the whole middle world. And the Bright Principle are not included in the middle world. So my proposal, Carol, for you is as one of the, you know, even saying I'm the owner of a company, then you're already in the context of ownership, that you can own something. Okay, well, that context is ordinary. And so, okay, then the context of your game world is somewhere around child, a little bit more than child, whatever, responsibility. Because you're already using the distinction, the value of ownership and of company, which is a legal entity that is born out of modern culture, capitalist, patriarchal empire. And it has one purpose, which is profit. And even if you try to have a different purpose, the legal construct of it will force you to have the purpose of profit. It just force you like that. And it also force you to have a hierarchy. Who owns it? Who's the employer? Who are the employees? What about the insurance? What about, it's all in there. It's all designed perfectly to serve the purpose of the capitalist patriarchal empire. So my proposal, if you're really trying to work with the team that you have, the first step would be a shift of context. How do you shift the context of the game world that you have and to shift it from a company to a game world, for example? And then there's great conversation and great transformational processes to have. We are in the middle of a game world building incubator. Who is a part of that game world building incubator? Devin. Okay. So we did 7 weeks in September, October, November, or something like that. And we're having another 7 weeks later in April. And part of this game world incubator is, what is the context of the game world that I'm creating and how to shift a context? Or how to even facilitate shifts for other, how to facilitate shifts of context for other people's game world. And then the job is to become a game world consultant. So I don't know if that's your job, you know, Carol, to become a game world consultant. I mean, and then your specialty, your value, your non-material value that you offer in the world is, how can entrepreneurs who have this, who have a wish, really a deep wish of serving a purpose different from profit or from hierarchy, how do they actually shift? Because without the upgraded thoughtware, it's modern culture painted green. It's greenwashing. If you don't shift the context, nothing changes. I mean, it's just like people who, it's exactly the same thing is, if you are extracting yourself from modern culture, but you don't upgrade your thoughtware, and then you go build a community and nobody has upgraded their thoughtware, the community will be the exact replica of what you had in modern culture. The exact replica. Because it's not where you live or how many gardens you have, or, you know, if you have a common room or whatever that makes a community a community. It's the upgraded thoughtware. You know, what is the context? So if that's really, you know, if that's something that matters to you, like if something that you, whatever your company, your game world, you want to create a shift there, you can contact me and I'll post a request in this game world incubator and you can have a conversation with one of the people who are training themselves to create this shift and to see, you know, what is needed, what's the next step, how, you have to do it only one step at a time. You can't, you know, come into your office and say, we are changing context, you know, and you're putting a big flag, you know, it doesn't really work because you need this connection with people and people allow people to go through their own liquid state. So if you want that, yeah, reach out to me and you can have a conversation.
Thank you.
Cool.
And there is also this, this is one part, and I faced all you said, and I know that I shouldn't do bright principles as a beginning. And now, but what about this in general, when people start discussing and there is like a heated discussion?
Yeah, I was gonna get there. So discussion is ordinary. Discussion is an opinion being fought against another opinion. I think I'm right, you're wrong. I think I'm right, you're wrong. And it's only opinions. So you can consider when you're having a discussion that your space has fallen into ordinary, of opinions versus opinion. And the space, one of the, another space that is possible is a discovery space. You know, this question of what is love? Well, that's a great space to go into a discovery about. You know, maybe not during the Bright Principle distillation, but I think that conversation is just not happening enough. What is love real? Like, what is love? What is the experience? What can I do with it? What is it, a, you know, what is the thoughtware that we get about love? Is there other thoughtware that we can use about love? And then it's a, it is a, the discovery space is that we just, we, it is, the context is that we're going on a discovery. The context is that we don't know. And a discussion is, I know, and I want to force my opinion on you. And it's like, you know, even if you're right, like even if you, if, even if, you know, God has given you the answer, you know, yeah, even if you had a vision and in all perspective, you're right, what does it matter? What does it matter for you to be right? It's a complete gremlin game. Because it's either you're right or you're in relationship. So a discussion is you're not in relationship. There is no connection. Okay, a discovery space is, God, this is what I've been experimenting with. This is my experience right now. This is my sensation right now. I'm noticing what I'm observing. I'm noticing what I'm noticing. What about you? How is it going over there? God, I have a completely different experience from you. How come we have different experiences? Where does that come from? Okay, well, for example, in, you know, in the archetypal domains, love is love. Okay, fear is fear. Anger is anger. An experience is an experience. The fact that we can share and have different perspective, different experience of a similar experience is the story that we make about them. It's the bullshit we make about them. Okay, well, it is really time for us to inquire about what kind of bullshit we make up. And it's not that bullshit is good or is bad, but it's, is it useful? Is it useful for me? Is it useful for my circle? Is it useful for, you know, what purpose you're serving? Is the bullshit that I'm creating useful for example, my bright principle, love, possibility, clarity, transformation, and empowerment? So that's the kind of bullshit that I look for. And so you can really immediately put it on the table with really one simple sentence is, are you trying to be right? That's the only, you can, that's the, that, and that will put, you're having a meta conversation. Are you trying to be right now? What would be your purpose of being right? And to not, it's not a rhetorical question. It's a true question. What is your true purpose? And, you know, it sort of, it feels kind of obvious that it will go something towards emotional fear, the big fear. Or what if I don't know? What if I'm not right? What if the world I lived in is completely fake and made up? You know, and that's mostly why people, you know, we have 500 websites online to start over. So much of our, the resources of possibility management is online, free YouTube video articles. And and it hasn't gone viral. You know, it's people are not jumping at each other's throat to get it because of that. Because the cost is your world will be destroyed. Whatever you thought, you who you were, or what you thought was right or true, or is, will be destroyed kind of over and over again. And but is that's also why people who come to possibility management are here. Like, this is why we're here, because in a way we want our world to be destroyed, because while it doesn't work so well or something like that, it's just, we know that something else is possible. So it's to keep this possibility with you as the space holder, something else is possible, and what's really going on over there that you would want to be right, that you would want to make other people wrong. Yeah. I mean, I think this is a great, this conversation needs to happen in some, even, you know, I mean, I feel really glad to be with you here, because I would like to work on noticing with you today, because and I don't know if you're going to go, you know, visit your family or be with friends or whatever's going to happen in the next few days. But it's a great space of experiment, I think. It's a great space of experimentation about how to shift from ordinary to extraordinary. And this simple question, are you trying to be right? You know, it will stop the space. So you could try that even in the next few days. Cool. Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I have one quick question. Just really short. I heard there's a difference between attention and energetic center. And I always had the, it, like, it's the same. Do you have, can you give, is like, what is the difference?
Great. Well, let's do the experiment together. So if you can put your 2 feet on the floor and kind of be with yourself. I mean, it's pretty clear that we have a physical center. That's a point of balance. I think all of you get this. And then we actually have a center in each of our 5 bodies. So try to feel your center in the emotional body. The center in the emotional body. Where is it, or what is it?
It's in the heart area.
Yeah, it's the heart. Can everybody feel that? Energetic, the emotional center is the heart. Great, we have our physical center, our emotional center. Where is the intellectual center?
In the head.
Yeah, in the mind. That makes sense? Can you feel it? I mean, it's not that it makes sense, it's that you have the experience that your intellectual center is in your mind. And it's not, I mean, it can feel like your brain, but I don't think it's your brain. It's the thing that kind of lives in the brain, but it's the mind. Okay. What about your energetic center? Can anybody describe that?
It's traveling.
Can you say it again, Maria?
It's traveling.
Okay.
It's jumping.
It's a tickling for me.
Okay. Traveling, jumping.
A tickling feeling.
Yeah.
It's my whole body emanating out. It's comes from my center and it kind of goes out.
Okay, what is the thing that goes out?
It's an energy.
Okay. Can you be more precise about what, because feelings are also energy, but they don't come out of your energetic center.
It's like rays. I don't know. I can't I can't really explain it.
Okay, raise, you were saying.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so mostly people, you've described what it does, what it feels like. What is it? So if the emotional center is the heart, intellectual center is the mind, the physical center is whatever, below, in the middle of your body, what is the energetic center?
For me, it's the energetic center is a small place, and in there's some kind of generator.
Yeah.
And if I, it could stand still, and if I have, and I could put it on or put it off, I could make more rotation in the generator or less.
Okay, what is it generating though? Okay, so Dorothea is just writing the aura, okay? Maren, what would it be generating?
I only have a metaphor. It's like a stone and or something like that, and in there is there's so much compressed energy, and I could use this energy and make it to expand it or to put it together again. And this, with this, I use the generator. And
okay, but what energy? Because feelings are energy, but they're not. That's not what's in there.
If you ask me for the energy, I would say it comes from the nothing.
Okay.
I couldn't describe it in another way. It's really, for me, in my sensation, it's like, if I ask for it, it's there.
Okay.
It's something like light. I mean, little things.
Okay. Anika,
please look at choice.
Carol, you were saying?
Choice, like I make a choice or don't make it.
Okay.
Strahlen, what the word?
Kian?
I just sense it's kind of this compact space that has a certain texture. And I just noticed that I actually can put my attention on my physical center, but not put my energetic center there. And if I really put it there, it changes really the radiation, like maybe what people said before, the aura or the sensation in my physical center. If I really put it there, it changes something. If I don't put it there, it's less vibrant.
Okay, but so you're already experiencing the distinction between your attention and your energetic center. Yeah.
Yes.
Great, but I still have this question.
Yes.
So, and I'll come back to your question, but what is this energy? What is the energetic center? What is it the center of?
For me, it's like a field. Like it's not, like I can't. It's somehow it's like everything outside me or something like that. Like it's like anything's possible or anything is like could come to me.
Okay, so potential.
Essence, my essence.
Okay, your essence.
Or essence. For even me, not mine. Even not my essence. It's the essence which created me or something.
Okay, the essence.
It's somehow related to intuition.
Okay.
I experience it as where my I don't know if it's actually the center of my being, but there's something I'm thinking about when I've given my center away, and the difference between that and actually bringing my center into my, bringing my center onto my physical center. And there's somehow it holds some essence of my agency in the world or something like that. And also it's mobile. My physical center is mobile in a really different way, but I can't just, it stays in the same place in my body, whereas my energetic center does not. It can go other places.
Okay, yeah. Is there anybody else?
I felt more about the energy. What I feel is about the energy, it's a really neutral energy, I with no direction. It's like you said, it's a potential which is there and could be activated or not.
Okay, so then it's sort of what Kian was saying also, Devin, is that in a way it gets activated when you put your center, your energetic center on your physical center.
This is one possibility, yes.
Okay. I have one other thing. I'm not so sure about the energy, like what the energy is that my energetic body is made up of. When I feel into my energetic body, mostly what is happening is a kind of, it almost is like my physical body, but a little bit out from my physical body, and subtle sensing. It's like subtle sensation.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what that's made of, but there's, I don't know, that's at least part of a function or something like that.
Okay. I mean, so I had something, you know, similar to Devin about this agency. It's like that my energetic body is, my center is where my responsibility is, where my agency is, where my will is. But sort of also, Carol, like my choice. So so that's the experience of when you give your center away, then what do you lose? You know, I don't think you lose your aura when you give your center away. I think your aura is always with you. Anyway, I never thought of it, but it's the power, you lose power. When you give your center away, you lose power. Okay, well, what power? Well, the power I'm getting is this agency to decide, to choose, to say, to declare. It's the responsibility. Okay, Sky Blue, you're going to say something?
Yes, it feels like a vibration. For me, it feels like a vibration. It has to do with vitality. So when it shifts, the vitality diminishes.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I would get that. You know, the more you're responsible, in a way, the more you're alive. Because the more you're aware. Kind of all goes together. But, and I mean, I think there's other, I don't know, it seems like there's other centers. And for example, Maren, you were saying this nothing. And we were working with that in the lab, and this nothingness that we have inside of us is this void. We have access to the void inside of us. You know, the void is, you can have an experience of it when you're hungry and you go in front of the refrigerator and open the refrigerator and there's nothing in the fridge that will fill you. Anybody ever had that experience? You look and you know, anything in there will not, you know, fulfill the void that you have inside of you. And what we've been discovering is that this void is this access to this nothingness, which if we're not initiated in the nothingness, it's so terrifying. It is so scary. And so it makes a lot of sense about modern culture that one of the purpose of modern culture is try to destroy this void, to fill this void. And so that's why we go online shopping and you know, get a new house and get a new computer, and all this consumerism has the purpose to try to kill this nothingness inside of us that we actually need to create. We need to have access to this nothingness to create something that doesn't exist yet. And so anyway, you can start experimenting with, when you feel this hunger, is what you're really looking for is a creation. And actually creation is energetic food. Yeah, creation is energetic food. And it's like, okay, what does the void want me to create? I mean, in a way it's this void, it's this access to this nothingness and what you want. And it's, so that's the creation tension. The creation tension happens between what exists and what you want. And if these things are not the same, then you have this creation tension, and the void is access to how you're going to make it happen. Something like that. We made a map. I'll send you the map. It's a very cool map about creation.
We'll
start making the website about it. And there's so much to discover. I was really excited.
So Kian, have some insight about center.
Yes.
I have some insight also about center. For example, if I give my center away to, if I give it to somebody, it's not that I don't have it. It's more like it's like a metaphor. I still have my center, but this center is like injected with someone else's energy. So it's not like I gave it away, but it's I still have it, but it's not mine anymore. It's something else now, but it's still in me. Like,
where do you get that? What's your experience that you don't?
I have one relationship when I gave my center away, and like this person's voice or energy stays with me, inside of me. So, and I still have my center because I focus on these things, and this is my. This is my reality for now, if I gave it away, but it's not me anymore. It's this person's, like, it's still my center. It's in me, but it has this person's qualities or this person's needs. It is fulfilling this person's agenda or something, but it's still in me. I never gave it away to somebody. My center is still in me, but it's not mine anymore, or something like this.
Okay, it seems a little, I get what you're saying. It seems a little confusing for me. And I think this, for me, it's really this experience this energetic experience that it is still my center, because I cannot rename it. You know, this is Carol's center. No, my center is always Anne-Chloe's center. But if it's with somebody else, then yes, I have their need, their priority, their value, their purpose. The responsibility is over there. I avoid responsibility and they have responsibility. So, and then there might be something else that you're talking about, is this bubble contamination, that you have your personal bubble of space that is contaminated with somebody else's energy. So you have conversation in their head, in your head with them. You have their feeling in your space, you have their need in your space. And I think those are two different phenomena because they have different healing process.
Okay.
And so it's just useful to distinguish them so you can do the steps to heal them, or like to whatever, transform them, shift, that are different. So the give your center way is you take back your center, put your attention on your energetic center, and move with your intention onto your physical center. So those are the forces. Kian, is when to center yourself, meaning to bring your energetic center onto your physical center, you put your attention on your energetic center. Your attention is a resource of your intellect. It's from your intellectual body, your attention. and you put it on your energetic center and with your intention, which is part of your energetic body, then you bring it back. It's your will. Your intention is your will. So you will it to come back onto your physical center. So that's the shift in terms of giving your center away. And to clean your personal bubble of space, there's a process that I've described in one of the Rage Club spaceholder training that you would have been in, Carol. And so I can refer, I'll send you the recording for those of you who want to learn how to clean up your bubble, because it's really powerful to just have your space again. I'll send the recording of that. Does that make sense, Carol?
Yeah.
Great. Aquarius, you wanted to say something, or are you just appreciating?
Just appreciating. Okay. Or not just, great. Appreciating.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I just want to say, Kian, I noticed that this confusion in other people, especially in the Rage Club spaceholder training, and somehow I think the language gets lost because there's this procedure about how to center yourself. And if you say the procedure without actually having the experience or experimented with yourself, how is it to really get back your center, to reclaim your center, to bring it back? Then you're just repeating what you've heard without actually having the experiential distinction. So as you're delivering Rage Club and work talks, bring that in, that yes, people can bring that transformation, that shift to other people, but first they need to be clear about what they're really doing. What are they really doing? Cool, thank you. Anything else? Okay. There was one thing that I wanted to say that maybe it wasn't clear for me when I started this possibility team, and now it's clearer, so I want to share it with you, is that in this team, for me, it is a space for me to research and to experiment. And so I will bring in stuff that I'm researching at the moment, that turned me on at the moment, that I don't have an answer for, and so this is not really going to be a space where we'll be practicing setting context or giving instructions for exercises or like basic spaceholder skills that, for example, we do in the Rage Club spaceholder training. And so these really practical, basic spaceholder skills, if you want to have access to those, I'm holding space for Rage Club spaceholder training next year, or you can join Rage Club or whatever. There are spaces that are made for that. And this space is really how to expand new dimension and territory of ourself that will support our space holding. And to also have this conversation about, I tried this in my space holding, it didn't work, or it worked, or do you have other possibility, and have this open space for question and possibility, but it will be a research space, just so that it's clear.
Wow, I just want to say thank you, Aunt Chloe, because I just realized how often, like I'm still back, I heard what you said, but I'm still with the centering thing, how often I thought I'm centered, but actually I just put my attention there. And now with this distinction of attention is actually a faculty of my intellectual body, I just noticed actually, wow, when I put my attention there, the energy or the movement really comes from up here. And that's so, like that really shifted something. That's amazing. I'm just, thank you.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, I do work talks and workshops about attention, because there's this sentence, I don't know who it comes from. I think it's from Gurdjieff, or it's something, without your attention, you have nothing. Without your attention, this work is over for you. Because only with your attention can you practice. Only with your attention can you notice what you notice. And it's so where your attention goes is where your energy flows. So, I mean, there's relationship between the attention and the energetic body. But if you don't have a grip on where you're putting your attention, then your box and the zombie standard human intelligence software will grab your attention and say, you know, pay attention to money, pay attention to your bills, pay attention to your emotional fear, put your attention on ordinary love, you know, and then you're hooked, and then it's over. Then there is no work of transformation. And so I think there's just not enough research and work done with attention. And especially for millennials, who we were born in a, you know, short attention span, like 3 seconds. Basically, that's how much attention most millennials have. So next YouTube video, next Instagram photo, like and scroll, and that's our, whatever, that's the life of the attention of a millennium. So will you work with that, or?
No, not yes, but not in the next month.
Okay.
Because next month I have something planned already to deliver work at a Rage Club.
You're delivering a Rage Club once a week.
Yes.
What are you doing the rest of the time?
Okay, I will do it.
Look, it's only if it really turns you on. But I have
yes, it turns me on. Definitely.
Okay,
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Cool.
And I'm actually scared because I really care about this. I'm really caring about help, like creating more awareness about attention and intention. I feel like this energetic work it really turns me on, and it scares me because I'm like, I'm weird when I want to do that. That's a fear. Or yes, thank you. Oh, yeah.
This is your next emotional healing process. Kian, how many past life have you done? How many past life emotional healing process have you done?
Maybe seven or...
About like being burned, being killed, being exiled?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, well, so maybe it's that, maybe it's something else. Maybe it's, you know, it could be some kind of contract that you made with your dad. You know,
yeah,
the men. But... Okay.
That's accurate.
Okay. Jorge, what? Is that, how do I pronounce your name? God, he's frozen now. You're still muted. Okay then. Okay, we have still 45 minutes, and I still would like to work with you with this noticing. And where I want to go with this is this discovery that I made during the lab last week about that there's a thing called the feeling cycle. How many people know about the feeling cycle? Okay. Just a little bit. Okay, so anyway, if you don't know about it, it's a fantastic healing process and transformational process that reveals so much about our emotional patterns. So that's one purpose. And the other purpose, in my own experience, is that it actually helps us to learn how to inner navigate our feelings and to feel feelings consciously. So if you can have I know Susanne also work with it, I think Maren work with it also. So the feelings practitioner, if you want to have a session to get to know the feeling cycle, just ask Maren, and I'll put the contact of Susanne, and they're a fantastic space holder for that process. But what I discovered last week is that we also have this thing that is called the noticing cycle. And that until we kind of look at it, is our noticing is unconscious. It is following our survival pattern. And the noticing is very close to attention. It's very close to, yeah, what I notice is also where I'm putting my attention on. So that if you have a noticing cycle that is serving an unconscious purpose, like a survival pattern, then the only thing that you can work with, the only thing that you experience or express are limited by this noticing. And there's a whole other world out there about what are you not noticing? You know, and why are you not noticing it? What in you is blocking you from noticing what you're not noticing? So this is where I would like to go today, to sort of get to know our noticing cycle. And I would do this in, let's do it in groups of three. Let's do it in groups of three, and we'll have about 5 minutes per person. And so there's one person, you're the facilitator, and you're practicing noticing what you're noticing. There's a scribe, and then the third person will be asking questions. I'll tell you how it goes. So the facilitator, you're really just sitting there, and you say, what I notice that I'm noticing is. What I notice that I notice is, for example, I'll start. What I notice is that I notice that I feel a pressure against the big toes of my feet and my heels. I notice that I just notice that I took a breath in. Air fills my lung. I notice that I feel scared, because I don't know where we're going. I notice that I notice a sound outside the door. I notice that my little finger is cold on my hand. Okay, so you just go like this, and you start each time with this sentence, I notice that I notice this. And try to, the short instruction is, try to not make a story. Try to be as close as possible as what is it that you're noticing. So for example, I could have said, oh, I noticed that Clinton moved on his chair outside. Okay, but that's a story from the sound. What I really noticed was the sound. So you say what you notice, not what the story of what you're noticing. Great. And then after, I would say maybe 2.5 minutes, sort of halfway through, we'll have 5 minutes per person. The third person, the questioner, you can start asking questions about what they're not noticing. So you say, are you noticing any smells? You know, I didn't mention any smells. Are you noticing your energetic body? Or what what are you noticing in your energetic body? What light are you noticing? What discomfort are you noticing? So you kind of open doors for them to start noticing things that they didn't say. Okay, and in the second person, the scribe, you just keep writing down what they're noticing, and we'll be working with the notes after that. It's clear? So 5 minutes per person, and I'll give you a little, I'll give you the time. Cool, here we go.
Chloe, the scribe that writes down what they're noticing and what they're not noticing, both?
No, only the answer. When somebody says, you know, when the third person says, what are you noticing about smell? Then they'll say, I notice that I notice that smell. And that's what you write. Yeah, mm-hmm. Okay. Great.
Thank you.
Let's go.
I write what you are saying, Phyllis?
You ask the, I'm writing and you ask the questions with, about what you don't think Devin noticed. Ask him questions.
Okay. Okay. So I'm the space holder in a way.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Go, Devin.
I noticed that I notice a cold on my left foot, on my toe, on my big toe on my left foot. I notice a clicking
sound. I notice that I notice, Devin.
Oh, right. Thank you.
I notice
a clicking sound. I notice that I notice light coming through, just light in my visual field. I notice that the floor is wood. I notice my softness against my ankle.
Yes, and everything is in the physical noticing and senses. Can you have a look for other
yes,
bodies?
Thank you. I notice a fear. I notice fear in my chest because I don't know what I'll say next. I notice also a fear, I think emotion, well, a fear of something behind me. I notice spaciousness in the middle part of my energetic body. I notice a kind of compression on my head.
You said some emotional things and energetic things. Can you check also archetypal and mental body?
Ingrid, the way that would support Devin, I think the most is to say, what about noticing what's happening with your center? And then he could put his noticing on that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
What about your center?
Yeah, what about his center?
Yeah, I noticed my center is, when I notice it, it's like a little bit high in my physical body. Sort of in my chest area, just as I noticed it. And I notice when I try to bring it down, it moves back up a little bit.
Can you check what you notice in your face?
Yes, I notice on my right cheek a little kind of pinching feeling near my nose, and I notice heat and wetness in my right eye.
What about thoughts?
Yeah, and voice. Thoughts.
Voice.
Sounds.
Okay. Thoughts. I noticed thinking about the next hour, what I'll be doing in the next hour. And I notice clicking and in terms of sound, this, I don't know how to describe it. This background sound that it's a little like rain or something, but it's very soft. Thank you.
What about your own voice?
Let me see. I notice that it's feels a little constricted, and I hear, I also notice that I notice a cracking, a crinkling sound.
Can you check voice and emotional body, or it's over?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Devin. Thank you, Phyllis.
I just want to say that there was a perfect group of three, and I'm a fourth person, so I would have wanted to be in a group. So I'm here, and so also it can be recorded, but I'll be asking questions, I think, mostly. Okay. Okay, here we go. Next constellation.
I can be the the possibilitator.
Devin, your space holder, and I write down?
Yes.
Okay.
I notice that I'm noticing a constriction in my chest. I notice that I'm noticing a feeling in my forehead that feels like an ache. I notice that I'm noticing the refrigerator making a sound in the background. I notice that I'm noticing my toes feel numb. I notice that I'm noticing some feeling in my stomach, in my center that feels stuck. I notice that I'm noticing that I just took a deep breath. I notice that I'm noticing the sound of my throat and the feeling that was in my throat that caused me to clear it. I notice.
Just a short coaching. Try to not use the word feeling when it's actually a sensation. Try to describe the sensation instead.
Okay. I notice that I'm feeling fear in my chest. I notice that I'm. I notice that I notice sadness. Throughout my body. And I notice that I notice my eyes tearing up and my voice changing. I notice that there are, on the periphery of my vision, I see birds flying. I notice that I want to cry, that my mouth was changing shape. I noticed that I just cut off that feeling. I noticed that I'm noticing that I just looked up. I noticed that I'm noticing that I just held my breath.
Phyllis, what are you noticing about your thoughts?
I'm noticing that I've been pretty much in the moment and not having lots of thoughts, which is unusual for me. Now I'm thinking, why did he say that? What did he see?
Can you say it again with I notice that I notice?
I notice that I notice. I notice that I notice. Now I'm thinking I notice that I'm noticing I'm confused because I'm not really clear about why I have to say both of the noticing. I notice that I'm noticing. Sensations in my body and not clear thoughts, but I know the thoughts are, I'm not, something about not doing this right or something about.
What about the quality of the space?
The space that we're in right now? Yeah, I'm noticing it's an incredible space. I'm noticing Devin's eyes are connected to mine and with passion, with feeling, with kindness, with care. I noticed I just had a thought that I need to say something about the other two. So I'm just I'm noticing that I'm noticing that thought. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phyllis. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phyllis.
To also answer your question, and because it's recorded here, mm-hmm. The noticing is, most of our noticing is unconscious. It's, then it's irresponsible, it's survival. And when the moment you say, I'm noticing that I'm noticing, then it makes it conscious. Because you're noticing what you're noticing. And before you were just noticing and not noticing what you were noticing. But you ongoingly noticing stuff. Does that make any sense to you?
I felt like I was noticing in the moment the entire time. So
yes. I'm meaning in your everyday life, like when you walk around in the world, even now, you're ongoingly noticing. But the fact that you might not be noticing what you're noticing makes it unconscious.
Okay. Yeah, I understand.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did somebody take notes for Phyllis?
I did that.
Yeah.
Great. Okay. So I'm the facilitator.
I'm the scribe.
And I'm the questioner.
I'm noticing that I notice that my eyes feel have a sort of dryness. I notice that I held my breath back.
Ingrid, it's I notice that I notice. Very
okay. I notice that I notice there's fear in my chest. I notice that there is in my digestion system air. I notice sounds, little chicking sounds. I notice.
Tell me about what you're noticing around your mouth and your face.
I notice that there is sadness in around my lips. I notice that there is a sort of loose feelings. I notice fear in my belly. I noticed that Devin was nodding. I noticed that Aunt Chloe was nodding now. I noticed the attention I notice a tension of your all three. I notice energy through that.
Tell me what you're noticing that you're noticing about your thinking.
I'm noticing that I notice to do it right, about thinking of doing it right and having the right formula. I notice that I notice to use the right formula. I noticed that there was some black stripe in the screen. I noticed that there is a tension in my shoulder, how these are called, this shoulder part, the lower part.
I noticed
that you were all nodding. So I noticed that you wanted to help me. It's a story. I did a story. I added a story. I notice the silence around me in this room.
What do you notice about purpose?
I notice that I want to do it right. It's a doing right purpose.
Tom, what are you noticing that you notice is the feeling in your shoulders?
I notice there is a tension, and it's the feeling is fear and anger. I turned my muscles here, was twinkled. I noticed that my voice is strange, is a story. I make again a story with the word strange. So I noted that my voice is monotone.
What about speed?
I noticed that I don't do so much pauses as I would like to do. I notice that this question, to look about speed, is relaxing some my shoulders.
Thank you, Ingrid.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. See you over there. Okay, we're gonna take a deep breath. How many of you noticed the shift of space or experienced a shift of space while you were saying, I'm noticing that I'm noticing? Okay. This is called the waking state. So you have a name for the experience. Is when you're aware of what you're aware of, or you notice what you're noticing. Called the waking state. And if you're not in the waking state, then you're in the sleeping state. And so one is not good and one is not bad. For example, if you want to parallel park your car, you want to be in the sleeping state. You want your muscle memory to do what it does. And you don't want to be noticing what you're noticing, otherwise you'll scrap your car. So there's moments you really, sleeping state is really useful. But in terms of space holding, space holding happens in the waking state. I also want to ask how many people, maybe you can remember what you were noticing, were noticing more than like 80% of your noticing was about you. Okay. I mean, so I noticed that I was in the group with Phyllis and Devin and Ingrid, that most of the noticing was what they're feeling, sensing, like physical sensation, emotional sensation, also some energetic, but there was a very few noticing about the space or about kind of noticing what's happening in somebody else. And so I think it's a revelation, unveiling of our survival noticing, that we notice extremely what, you know, I feel fear, I feel uncomfortable, I feel hungry, I notice that I'm thirsty, I notice that I need to shift, I notice that I need to scratch. You know, this is all what we're noticing, but that we actually have blocks to noticing others or the space or what's next or the access to the archetypal or what's possible or the potential, like all of that could be part of our noticing.
So I'd like to say that that the three of us before you entered noticed that right away. And I also want to say that I didn't really think outside the box, because a lot of the, I thought that was our, mostly what the experiment was about, is what we were noticing about ourselves.
Yeah, that wasn't the instructions. Yeah. No, the instruction is, what do you notice that you notice?
Yeah.
I mean, and Rose, also Phyllis said, I just want to share the question that you had about why do we say I've noticed that I notice? And is the thing is that we noticing ongoingly, our box and gremlin are ongoingly noticing for our survival. If we weren't noticing, we wouldn't be able to give our center away, play nice, play cute, attack, be defensive, be right. Like, we wouldn't be able to do any of these things if our box and gremlin weren't noticing. Okay, but so that's the unconscious noticing. And so the fact of saying, I notice that I notice, puts the attention on the noticing. And then all of a sudden, what was unconscious becomes aware, like conscious, so becomes seen. So this is why this sentence of, we say, I notice that I notice, so I'm aware that I'm aware of. It's the same thing. Okay, anything else that you noticed?
I notice that I have this story, or I notice within myself, I notice within myself and within other people that there, it seems to me that I and others have is this kind of habitual way of noticing oneself. And by that, actually keeping myself in a certain way of how I am used to feel. And but then I noticed that, and I noticed that another part of me was like, okay, now I want to feel different. And I noticed how part of me was looking for how I could feel differently, or what else is to notice in my experience. Like, where am I ecstatic? Where am I feeling really spacious? And because I have my noticing is more like, where's the pain? Where do I feel contracted? And then I noticed that there's something unnatural, like this can become unnatural to try to notice the good stuff. And so, yeah, basically these two things I noticed, and I noticed that there might be something like a natural noticing process that would unfold, or that's a story I made, that would unfold myself in a natural way. And like between these two extremes of noticing how I feel, where I feel contracted or pain, and where I feel good. Like, where's the natural unfoldment of noticing for connection, for example? Yes.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's what I would call this, the noticing cycle. That's this habitual, so that we feel familiar. We feel like we always feel. And then this ability to make a gap. So there's a lot I would want to do with you, but we have 15 minutes. So there's another part that I will skip for today, but it's this noticing what you're noticing with. So right now we just did, I noticed that I noticed this. Skip it. Which part of you are you using to notice that? So I'll give you some example. We won't be working with that, but you can practice it during the week. So you might be noticing with wanting to avoid responsibility. You might be noticing with, I need to have a problem in my life. So then you're only noticing things so that you have problems. Or you're noticing what makes you feel afraid. Okay, well, what is that really? So it could be an expectation on yourself. I'm noticing with a self-manipulation expectation. Like Ingrid was saying, I need to do this right. Okay, what are you, this is the story. She was noticing, she was noticing that she has a story, I have to do this right. Okay, well, what are you using to notice that? So is it an expectation on yourself? Is it a voice? So then you're noticing is through the voice of an external authority figure. So this is really cool stuff. So you can practice that. But what I would like to do, and we'll only do it for whatever, 3.5 minutes per person, is to go a little faster in this noticing, but to notice, to try to notice what is your cycle? What is your noticing cycle? Where does your attention move from here to there, and then here to there, or here, here, and here? You know, whatever. I think there's four or five main thing that we put our attention on, that we move from one to the next, it seems to me. But don't limit yourself to that. So try to say, okay, I see again that my noticing is moving back to this, and it's moving back to this, it's moving back to this. Does that work? Okay, we're going back into the same groups, and it's going to be about, 3.5 minutes. I'll let you know. Great, here we go.
Can you explain this again, Aunt Chloe? I didn't follow that.
Yes, you're going into the same group, and then you're noticing your usual, what you usually notice. You say, okay, I'm noticing that I'm afraid. Okay, now I'm noticing that I have a voice. Okay, now I'm noticing that I'm afraid again. Okay, I'm back to fear. Okay, I'm back to noticing the voice. So try to find what your pattern is. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Great.
Cold again, specifically my hands, but cold across my hands. I notice fear and trembling in my jaw. I notice.
Devin, maybe to make this work, it would be I'm noticing physical sensation.
Yeah.
I'm noticing fear, and then kind of notice what the grosser thing.
Yeah, I notice physical sensation specifically. I don't want physical sensations like cold, like wanting warmth. I notice fear, and it just emotional fear really is what it feels like. I notice.
You're already noticing.
Yeah, it was something about the. I noticed another level of fear, actually. Okay. I noticed another level of fear of like, oh no, I'm being off-putting, was kind of the sentence. I notice a sadness come up after that. Then I notice my hands again and my feet cold. It's a physical unpleasant sensation. And yeah. And then I just noticed I smiled saying that, like, I noticed that I notice my, again, physical sensation. I noticed that I notice a sound. I noticed that I notice, again, that am I doing this yet? It's not quite, am I doing this right? But this coming back to the space of like, this is, that's kind of how it goes. This isn't right what I'm saying, something like that. I notice that I notice yeah, and then the sadness. So another emotional thing, but the sadness about that being what I'm noticing. I notice my hands are cold. I notice that I notice, yeah, okay. Gosh, it seemed like just two or three things maybe over and over.
So I'm adding this, hopefully, as I hope people can see it. But so can you say the three or four thing that you're bouncing around with Devin?
Yeah, physical discomfort.
Yeah.
Some sort of emotional fear. And then connected to that, something like, oh no, this isn't going well. Like, I'm doing it wrong. I'm being off-putting, something like that.
Yeah.
But you is what the name is, coming from me is a sort of self-critic. Then the thoughts are going on, and it's a sort of self-critic or self-blame or something like that.
And then there's a fourth one.
One that I said was sadness. Also, I noticed that there were things that I noticed that I didn't know how to articulate, so I kind of skipped them, but it was like, and I won't even try right now, but I just noticed that it was subtler than the four big things.
Okay. I think it seems to me that the sadness came right after the self-criticism, then, yeah. Then there was a sadness. Phyllis, you were gonna say something?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were thoughts that came in between there, especially when your eyes went off to the side. That mm-hmm. was in between feelings.
But I think it's an accurate experience of there's this gross noticing, and then there's a bunch of other stuff that are happening, but barely being noticed under this noticing cycle.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. This was really pretty revealing.
Okay, I'm next.
Yes.
I'm noticing a physical sensation that I have to pee. I'm noticing some tension. I notice that I notice tension in my shoulders. I notice that I notice that I'm looking at the space, particularly looking at Devin. I notice that I'm noticing.
Phyllis, just as a, so what for? Because that will be your pattern. So the physical sensation, Devin said it's discomfort. What are you noticing for?
What am I noticing for? I don't understand.
Okay. So you notice that, you notice Devin. Why?
Oh, yeah.
The purpose.
I was looking at his eyes and looking for connection. I was noticing, looking for connection.
Okay.
I'm noticing that something about the space that I don't know. I'm noticing that I don't know how to connect with the whole space. I'm noticing a physical sensation of just swallowing. And there was some fear around that. And the fear was, yeah. So I'm noticing that tension in my middle body from my heart down to my center around not doing this right. I'm noticing, Ingrid just moving. And it's about, and I'm wondering what she's thinking. I'm noticing that I just had a feeling inside of me that, because I saw in Chloe, you nod her head, that I did something right. Okay. And that was an external authority kind of a deal.
So come to an end, Phyllis. Great.
Okay.
Thank you. And this is, can you kind of feel your way through your noticing pattern?
Yeah, it was, a lot of it was, well, I was noticing my own, what was going on in my own self, my own body and thoughts. And then I really put the focus on the space and was picking, basically giving my center away and picking up what other people were, reading other people and making up stories.
Okay. I mean, so one of the things that I noticed in your pattern is that there's a pattern for noticing for connection.
Yeah.
You know, am I connected? Are they connected? Something like that. So there's this search for connection. And then what are other people thinking of me? I'm noticing what other people are thinking of me.
And I wrote that down. I wrote that down, that looking purpose for being accepted. I don't know if it's right.
Yeah, and Ingrid, you're using different words than Phyllis is using.
Oh, okay.
And so therefore, you might be right, but it helps in terms of noticing to use the same words, because that's where the pattern is. Yeah.
Thank you.
Before we shift,
Just that it, you're noticing, maybe this was kind of already said, but that it shifts from internal to external fairly, it happens fairly quickly, but you're inside yourself and then it's what's happening out there.
Yeah, I mean, let's shift to the third one. It's sort of, there's a bounce back that seems pretty fast between what are they thinking and then fear.
Yeah.
Am I connected and fear?
Yeah.
And it's kind of goes ting, 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 ting like this. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Okay. I noticed that I notice my diaphragm more relaxed. I notice that the regard from Anne Chloe, which was concentrated and then face down. I noticed that Devin has his hands on his front.
For what? You notice that? What's the purpose?
The purpose is observation. Yeah, he does that.
Okay.
I notice that my inner, there is more calm in me. I noted that Phyllis has a sadness around her mouth. I notice that you are. That Aunt Chloe is biting her lips. I notice that a pause I notice my own breath being in a different speeds.
I notice that I'm noticing.
I notice that my breath has sometimes different speed. I notice that my voice makes sometimes pauses. I notice.
What's the purpose for pausing your breath or for the speed of your breath?
I'm sort of bringing it to a close because it's already time. And I just want to have a minute. I'm going to close the room, but we have a minute to
notice the pattern of your breath.
Thank you.
One quick thing. I noticed you did this twice, but you said, you said something more, like my diaphragm is more calm and something else about more. But it was like something about the past, that you were being the past and your present, notice, comparing the past to now.
Thank you.
What I noticed is that you only noticed completely neutral physical characteristic of people. So I don't know if you've had a practice for a long time of just of noticing. Have you had a spiritual practice of noticing?
I do that very often at home, I do that. Yeah.
Okay, but then you're missing, you're only at the physical level and you're missing a whole, so that's the pattern that I notice, is that you're trying to be so neutral that you only notice the physical domain, kind of as a way of shielding yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so you're missing all other four body and a bunch of other dimension.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
I don't know what happened to Phyllis.
Yeah, Phyllis just took off. Okay. It is already time. I wish we had 2.5 hours to work with this. I think it's really cool. So my proposal is I will end the space so that people who have appointment and commitment, you can go do it. But my proposal is for the coming week is to both of these things. If you could write down what is your noticing pattern, just share it in the group. It's 3, 4, 5 kind of gross noticing pattern purpose. And then the other thing is if you start noticing what you're noticing with, and to share with us, what do you used to notice with, and what else have you discovered you could notice with? You could also do experiments like Kian did. What else could I notice? What else could I use to notice? And then what else do I notice when I use these things, these other things? Mm-hmm. And kind of have a report. And that would be great material for us to work with each other. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Aunt Chloe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
See you next week.
Thank you so much, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.